It is my distinct pleasure to welcome Kanwal Rekhi. He is amongst the most known faces in Silicon Valley, in some ways the guru for entrepreneurs who has mentored over 2,000 entrepreneurs. Kanwal, it's a true pleasure to welcome you.
Thank you.
Kanwal, you are amongst the founders of Thai, going back to the early days. This germinated as a very small idea, which is now into 57 chapters, 14 countries around the world, 13,000 members plus. When you see it now, ThaiCon becoming the world's largest conference for entrepreneurs, and the unique distinction is that it's entirely driven by a volunteer force who are very passionate for the cause of entrepreneurship. Did you and the others envision that it will grow this way?
You know, I mean, we had some idea that this, you know, this idea will have some legs in Silicon Valley, but it will grow beyond Silicon Valley here. You know, we had not thought of that one. And you know, if for the first several years, I think till 97, 98, it was only in Silicon Valley, until we got a telephone call from Boston, hey, we like what you guys are doing, can we, form a chapter here? And so we didn't know what that meant. He says, well, I don't know what chapter means. This idea has, merits, and here are our bylaws, here's our logo, and go form a chapter, and it, so chapter in Boston and chapter in LA were formed, around the same time, about a month apart. And we gave them our, intellectual property bylaws, but each one was an independent chapter. And we kept getting requests from other areas. 11 such chapters were formed between 98 and 2000. And, Chicago, New York, among them, and Bombay, Delhi, Bangalore, and Chennai. So, so this idea was not something that we were evangelizing or pushing from here. Other people were. It was a sort of a pull from the other side. And so, after 11 chapters had been formed like that, somebody said, we have our reputation. We have our ideals. We need to make sure there's a quality control. Nobody uses our name, our brand, to do some funny stuff. And Sitya Prahlad by that time had become very much of a part of the Thai movement. And he proposed that we form a Thai global central entity, distinct from Thai Silicon Valley, which basically has a job of maintaining the brand and its quality, and enforces, certain standards about what's allowed, what's not allowed. So this thing had a life of its own. It's a labor of love. It's not something anybody's making money off. And so not something it's not a corporate entity that you need to expand. But idea, it was an idea whose time had come.
The core value kind of remains the same because that has been consistent.
So the core values have remained spent, same simply because the people were opting in because they were liking those values. It was attracting the people who resonated with those values. So, it wasn't that we were pushing our values on anybody. So, it was the believers who believed in the core values that we had developed. And we had put that, if you remember that, we used to have a philosophical framework. That has stayed unchanged. So it was not because we asked people to adopt our values, sign in blood, that they will not change. It was an opt-in process. It was a process where people liked those values, people liked what we were saying, people liked what we were doing, and they wanted to be like that. And so I used to tell people that this thing will not require much policing. It's not, we're not attracting the crowd. We are attracting the crowd that believes in entrepreneurship, that believes in wealth creation, that believes in giving back. And so I think that has turned out to be the case. There was some trouble, because you always end up having people who want to use this platform for personal power. But that's been minor. That's been a minor thing. There was a very strong revulsion against that one in the community, and we very quickly purge the people. This is a way to pay back. This is a movement of wealth creation, creating the virtuous cycle of becoming an entrepreneur, creating the wealth for yourself, then reaching out and helping to the next guy, and hopefully he will repeat the cycle. And that process is well underway now.
You know, when people like you and Kailash and Suha joined us, mm-hmm. and then everybody also sort of been attracted to the right kind of people. But the challenge, is for the second generation of Indian Americans. Mm-hmm. What do you think we can do to attract that crowd now?
Well, I think we are beginning to do it now, right? Yeah. There was a worry for a while. There was a worry for a while that Thai was needed by the first generation, Indian Americans. Because they were not getting a seat on the head table, so they had to make their own table, there was a fear that the second generation people who are benefiting, from the ties such as, which is giving the Indian Americans a very good brand, and the may not need Thai, as a platform to self help. But Thai had this other side of need to give back. Successful people have a need to give back, and that part still stays. So that fear has turned out to be somewhat unfounded, even though the Indian Americans now don't need their own private platform. But Thai platform has become a mainstream platform. So we have always been open. We have never been exclusive in our approach. We have always been inclusive. Everybody's welcome, the Chinese, the Indians, the mainstream whites, everybody's been welcome, and the language of the Thai has always been English. Nobody has felt outside, and there's nothing political, cultural about Thai. It's a mainstream Silicon Valley values, create wealth, enlarge the pie, share the wealth, spread the wealth, and so the Thai values by and large are Silicon Valley values, and so nobody has to do any compromise. The fear that you will become ethnic if you join the ethnic groups, which most of us had, we want to be mainstream, has not been been true with relation to Thai. So we see younger people joining, volunteering. Thai is a platform. A wonderful platform to volunteer from, and as a result, Thai has always attracted people who have a desire to volunteer for a good cause.
So, taking the cue from your last statement on the value of Silicon Valley, mm-hmm. when you started your first venture, the atmosphere was very different compared to where we are now. Now, if you go on Samuel Road, pretty much every fund has more than one Indian name there. But when you started, it was obviously a different challenge.
Yeah. Well, so, the Indians, there's an Indian journey, Indian American journey, started in the 60s, right? So when you got to U.S., your branding was the branding of India, third world country, a sort of hopelessly poor. And by definition, you guys weren't very sharp and smart. That was all implied in that one. After a few years here, it became very clear to the people, especially at universities in the beginning, the Indians were somewhat special. They were sharp. They were good in mathematics. They were very good in studies. And so a personal brand started to become smart people. Smart people, good in mathematics, good in technology, good in sciences. But that brand was sort of single-dimensional brand. They can design stuff in the bathroom, they can design, they can write software. That happened in the 70s. To become an entrepreneur or to become, Indians were not becoming managers. They were not seen as leaders yet. They were seen as a good individual contributor. This stuff works. Can they sell? Can they market? Can they manage people? Can they manage money? The other attributes you need, those had to be proven, still proven. When some of us in the 80s, Suhash, Prabhu Doyal, myself, Kailash, the list is a long list. when we took the plunge in 80s, we had to fight that bias. Yeah, we know you can design stuff, we know you can write software, but that's not enough. That's not, you know, so you had to prove, you know, and it was very hard environment, because a very hostile environment, in this, you know, why are you doing something which is not natural to you? You guys are good at, you know, why don't you stick with what are you doing?
Technology
and not entrepreneur. Yeah, why aren't you happy being a good engineer, a good programmer? Why are you trying something, you know, like selling and marketing, that's not, you know, natural to you? So those kind of, you know, comments were there. By late 80s, you know, enough of us had started to show, you know, that we were able to sell, we were able to market, we were able to manage, we were able to take companies public. And, most of those doubts were being laid to rest by the time we formed TIE. Yeah, but the basis of TIE was the journey that most of us had early on was very lonely journey, very lonely journey. There were very few people who believed in us, you know, very few people who encouraged us, you know, very few people, you know, were available to us to talk to. You know, when you had some issues, you know, you couldn't talk to anybody, because the first thing they would say is, why don't you do a bad to be in what you are good at? You know, instead of listening to you. So, you know, so when we succeeded, we said it was very, very hard, very, very difficult for us. It shouldn't have been that bad. You know, why don't we become the mentors, you know, the people who inspire, people who encourage, you know, who become available to younger entrepreneurs, so they have somebody to talk to. And so that was the starting point of TIE. And of course, you know, like I said before, you know, timing was just right. You know, this was now early 90s, and Silicon Valley was starting to boom again. And so that nuclear explosion took place, you know, after the TIE was launched. You know, we expected 100 people to show up at our first Titan. More than 500 people showed up, and we knew, you know, that this thing has legs, and you know, we had never looked back.